Dorothy looked up from the table. They were already two rubbers down. Four spades was going to be hard to make, and the night was edging towards its end.
Harold, do you have the time?
Her partner responded without emotion. Yes, it's five... to murder.
Gosh, thought Dorothy, I shouldn't have overcalled his diamonds.
So that's coming along nicely. On my right, James Barnard, who has a strong aversion to peas. Felicity Barnard, who spends a lot of time sorting Lego into small drawers. And their captain, Andrew Lay, who recently foraged 2 kilograms of wild garlic and took it on a 3-hour train journey. United by a passion for polyphony, they are the Antiphons. Andrew, as a TV show, what improvements would you make to Only Connect?
Gosh, possibly a physical endurance element, much like Squid Game, perhaps.
I mean, that's a genuinely excellent idea. We should do that. You'll be playing your Squid Game tonight against, on my left, Alice Nettleship, whose favourite bird is a snipe. Charlotte Ashton, who was her primary school backstroke champion for 2 years in a row. And their captain, Ben Worth, who has watched the film With Nail and I over 100 times and recently treated his family to a detour to visit a phone box that featured in the film. United by their worship of warm weather, they are the Suncatchers. Ben, do you enjoy our missing vowels round, or do you think it's a weird tacked-on thing that skews the points unfairly and has nothing to do with the rest of the quiz?
Good question. Well, I enjoy it, and it went well for us in our last game, so I'll stick with it. We'll see how it goes. Ask me at the end of the show, and I may have a different answer.
Well, we will see, because at the end of the show, one of these teams will still be in the competition, and sadly, one of the teams will not. And to decide which is which, we're going to play a quiz. You won the toss at Suncatchers, but you've thrown your opponents in first. So, Antiphons, please pick a hieroglyph.
Two reeds, please.
Two reeds. What is the connection between these clues? Here's the first.
Okay, this doesn't make sense together, do they? Is that two different separate things? Next, please. No. Next, please.
Well, a bit of Reading Jail. They're not all alliterative.
Next, please.
One second.
A bit stumped here, but... yeah, two R's. We don't know.
Not it, I'm afraid. Suncatchers, do you know?
Pockets.
Not it. Now, I must say, even though you didn't get it, I think this is one of the all-time great questions. You're getting there with two R's. The two R's are reading and Reading. You can have a reading room, and there is a basketball team, the Reading Rockets. A reading lamp and Reading Jail. Reading glasses, Reading Jail is a bit of a clue, and of course, reading, writing, and arithmetic, and the Reading Festival. Two R's and two Edings as well. So, no points there, but Suncatchers, you may choose a question. What would you like?
Water, please.
Water will be for you. The music question, your first lovely musical clue, is coming in now.
Next, please.
During their mission, heard a politician making speeches as they traveled by.
Next, please. Do you know what time it's on my radio. Okay. Next, please. That's from a film, isn't it?
This is
it. Yeah, so visitors from outer space. We think they're all visitors from outer space.
Exactly so. Visitors from outer space or extraterrestrials. What did we hear?
So the last one was the theme from E.T.,
yes.
Extraterrestrial. Mm-hmm. The third one was Starman by David Bowie.
Yeah.
And we don't know what the previous two were.
Wonderful Ella Fitzgerald singing Two Little Men in a Flying Saucer.
Okay.
And the first one is from a concept album. Did you recognise it? The piece we heard was called Concerning the UFO Sighting Near Highland, Illinois. And it's, of course, from Sufjan Stevens's concept album, Illinois, or Sufjan Stevens Invites You to Come On, Feel the Illinois. And as a person who'll go a very long way for a pun myself, I salute the person that released that album, even though the piece of music gave you nothing clue-wise. But you did get the answer, extraterrestrials, for a point. Antiphons, what's next?
Lion.
Lion it is. What is the connection between these clues? Here's the first.
Next piece. Yes. Why things have been named after when we never. Let's go for next. Just to be sure.
No, no, no.
Next, please.
Yeah, I think so.
These are all reasons for something to have been named Apple.
Very well done. Coming in after just three clues. You didn't need to see the fourth one to represent Isaac Newton. And obviously the thing that's named Apple is Apple. Nobody really knows why it's called Apple. Some people say it was a homage to the Beatles. Steve Jobs himself gave various answers. He used to work at an orchard. One time he said, because he used to work at Atari as well, and he said he just wanted a name that would come before Atari in the phone book to get one over on them, so he chose Apple.
We've been using aardvarks.
I mean, I think we know who had the last laugh there, Amazon. And representing Isaac Newton is another theory that people had. Reasons why it might be called Apple. Well done. What would you like for yourselves?
Charlotte?
Twisted Flax, please.
Twisted Flax. What do these clues have in common? Here's the first.
Next, please. So it's fast.
Is finite Christmas
also? Could be.
Would you fast
for Christmas? Could be. Should we take the next one?
Take the next one.
Next, please.
Made a penance.
That's like repaid.
Reparation.
Next, please.
Seconds.
I think they'll give their name to sort of special days, feast days.
I need something very specific.
Shrove Tuesday.
Not just any feast day, but the specific feast day, Shrove Tuesday, is known as these things in different languages. Yeah. What do you know about any of the clues?
I thought it was gross.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember in French.
Mardi Gras is the
French, Fat Tuesday. Made penance, obviously, that's just to shrive, to confess, to make penance in English, Shrove Tuesday. Fasting, like the Fastnachtsdienstag in German, because it's the night before the fasting starts. An explosion, now this is a complicated one. It's something like Springidag. I mean, my Icelandic pronunciation is not, you know, what it might be. But it's explosion day. And there's various... I mean, some people say it's actually come from quite a dry German word, meaning to sprinkle holy water, but some people say it's from to explode, because you eat so much you might explode. So they have, on the Monday, it's Bun Day in Iceland, so they eat buns all on the Monday, and on the Tuesday, they eat salted meat, often horse, but it could be anything, with a sort of lentil soup, with a bean soup, and the idea is you eat so much you might explode, so that's Explosion Day. It's worth, you know, if you've got time, just going online and reading the full account of what Icelanders do in that particular week, because it's kind of mad and brilliant. Antiphons, what would you like?
Eye of Horus.
Eye of Horus. What do these clues have in common? Here's the first.
Next, please. Right, OK, so that's... Yeah. So in a particular moment,
things,
something happened.
Are there things that happened in the book instead of the film or not?
Oh, in the film and not in the book?
I don't know if there's a book.
Next, please.
Taxi.
Yeah. Yes?
Is Butch in a taxi? I mean, the second one's
principal. Yeah, just going to use it.
Next, please.
Yeah, go for it.
Yeah, we could have come in earlier, but done in a taxi.
They are all done in the back of a taxi. What can you tell me about the clues?
They're done in the back of a taxi.
Holly Golightly's Breakfast at Tiffany's.
That's Breakfast at Tiffany's, the last scene with Audrey Hepburn and George Peppard, and, you know, she realises she loves him. In The Apprentice, after they're fired, they go away and say what they think about Alan Sugar. Maybe they don't tell you everything they think about Alan Sugar, but they share some thoughts in the taxi. Come dine with me. What happens in that show?
They hold up numbers or something after to judge the evening they've just had.
Watch it. I don't really approve of that show. I mean, it's very entertaining, but the idea of getting you go for dinner and then you criticise, you know, the meal you were served.
Isn't that what actually happens, though, in real life as well?
It is, but it's good manners to pretend that it doesn't. And what about Clue One?
We're not sure of that one.
That's Pulp Fiction.
It's Pulp Fiction. It's Bruce Willis, isn't it? Butch Coolidge.
Talking to Esmeralda Villalobos, I think, the name of the taxi driver.
Good Tarantino knowledge. All things that happen in a taxi. Well done. And you get your own question now. The Horned Viper, I expect it'll be the picture question. We haven't had it. What can you glean from these pictures? Here's the first.
Shutter.
Is that a lighthouse
inside? Next, please.
Camera,
I think?
Yes.
Yeah. Let's give it a try. Films that have camera terminology in the name, parts of a camera.
I think I'm going to give you the points. I think you've come in early, you have spotted the hidden puzzle, which is that it's parts of a camera. The rest of the clues aren't all films.
Okay.
So you've got a little bit specific there, but it's about the camera parts, it's about those names. I'll show you the other clues. What are we looking at?
It's a Ford Focus and two lens being lens.
The great late Len Goodman, or lens as we're seeing here. So it is all parts of a camera. Well done. That means at the end of round one, the Antiphons have 3 points, the Suncatchers have 5. Sequences time. As the sequences round, what would come forth? Antiphons, I'll be asking that of you first, but about which hieroglyph?
Horned Viper, please.
Horned Viper. You'll be seeing the first clue in a moment. I'd like to know what comes forth. Time starts now.
Next, please.
All the letters are 1 point in Scrabble.
Yeah.
F5, you know, it's work.
Next, please.
X is Roman numerals and then Scrabble, is it?
Yeah.
Oh, yes, yes. IV. V's
so,
yes,
so we're going for 50 L.
Yeah.
Is.
Oh, shit, here we go.
Two.
One.
Is it not one?
It's two. Is it?
I think it's two.
50 brackets, 2 points.
Oh, I'm afraid that's not the right answer. Suncatchers, do you know?
50 brackets, 3 points.
Not it either. Oh. Brilliantly, Antiphons, you have worked out we're in a world where Roman numerals are Scrabble tiles. The I or 1 would be worth 1, the V is worth 4, the X is worth 8, but in a game of Scrabble, the L is worth 1 point only. Just 1. I think it's worth 2 in Words with Friends, which you might have been playing, but then the sequence doesn't work, because then a V would be worth 5. So, unlucky you solved the puzzle, but not the right answer. Suncatchers, what would you like?
Lion, please.
Lion. OK, what would come forth this time? Here's the first.
So, we made a film to them. What's that one? They went down to four members. Next, please.
Is this where they had? Then they had 4 number ones in a row, maybe. Did the Beatles have 3 number ones in a row? 2 number ones in a row and 1? Just 1? One hit
button. Can I take the next one to confirm?
Yeah. No, no. If it's Christmas number ones, then we just need 1 that's had 1.
But they didn't have, that wasn't their 4th one.
Oh, right, OK.
Next, please.
Catch it,
2
in the jar at the same time.
Because that's loads of people, so 2 number ones in a row. She would have had me, yeah.
2 seconds.
So just something that's had 1 number one.
We're going to say, I'm trying to think of a number one, Dexy's Midnight Runners, 1982.
That is an answer that would work in the sequence. Very well done. And why?
So I think it's the number of number ones they had in that calendar year.
Exactly so. So the Spice Girls had 4 number ones in 1997. The Beatles had 3 number ones in 1966. Olivia Rodrigo in 2021. So we need pretty much anybody who had a single number one in a particular year. We went with Steve Brookstein in 2005, but you, perhaps dating yourself, went with Dexy's Midnight Runners from 1982. Great Come On, Eileen, I'm assuming you were thinking of. Great track. Yeah. Antiphons, what would you like?
Twisted Flax, please.
The Twisted Flax, what would come forth in the sequence? Here's the first.
Right, okay, it's a very rude, rude, but I didn't, I'm not sure it existed. Well, possibly, I'm not sure. Next, please. Yes, but what's going on? What's the scene? Yeah.
What's the slant?
Next, please.
That definitely used to exist. It's very rude. Oh, no, it didn't. Yeah.
What's doing this?
No, really, it was there.
That's our
no,
top
it
Wales.
Right, so is it something geographical?
Well, it's not sequence. So...
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Is it going round or something?
2 seconds.
We'll go Harris to Esbjerg.
Not it. I sort of love this question as well in a completely different way. Not it. Suncatchers, do you know?
Dover to Calais.
That would be an acceptable answer, although you've expressed it slightly differently from the other clues. Do you know why?
No, we just guessed the most obvious ferry crossing that we could think of.
Yes. It's the... I mean, as I say, this question is triumphant in a whole different way. It's the busiest sea routes to and from the UK. I mean, we've got them all coming into the UK, but it has actually based on numbers going in both directions. And interestingly, the Hook of Holland to Harwich was only recently declared the fourth busiest sea route to the UK, controversially knocking to Portsmouth, as I'm sure you knew, off that prized fourth spot. And we're going towards the very popular route Calais to Dover, or indeed Dover to Calais. Which is your favourite, Ben, of the routes?
Of those, I haven't done any for a long time. We've done Portsmouth to St Malo last couple of years on holiday, which is nice. Overnight crossing, disco for the kids on board, have a beer. Yeah, that's very pleasant.
Did you spring for a bed?
Yes. Cabin. Yeah. It's nice. You have a couple of beers, then go to sleep, wake up the next morning, you're in France and a little way down as well. So not
I mean, I think we've all had a couple of beers, woken up the next morning, we were in France, haven't we? Not always on a ferry. But yes, well done for the bonus. And you can choose your own question. What would you like?
Two reeds, please.
Two reeds. What would come forth in this sequence? Here's the first.
There's a book about Patch the Dog, by the way.
Oh, yes, but...
Most popular name.
Next, please. Jason Cat.
I don't know.
Next, please.
Lupita
and... OK, so yes, what was it? We go backwards.
Backwards in time.
What was the first?
Lupita.
What was the first?
Oldest.
Meg?
Or longest serving.
Yeah.
Shep?
3 seconds.
We'll try Shep dog.
Not the answer, I'm afraid. Antiphons, your chance for a bonus point.
We were going to say that. We'll go... Oh, there must be another one. Benji, dot and ask David, wasn't it? Benji, brackets dog.
Some of our older viewers will be barking at the screen in frustration that you don't remember the great first Blue Peter pet, Petra. Shep was John Noakes' dog, but later on, because John Noakes' first dog was Patch, which is at the beginning of the sequence, and Fred Frieda. I think we maybe recognised it at that point as Blue Peter Pets, because we remember that story, because there was a tortoise called Fred, and a viewer wrote in and said, that's a female tortoise, and they renamed it Fred. I mean, that's... I can barely see the screen. That's someone that's put on their glasses, isn't it? They've noticed a female tortoise going back towards Petra, the first great Blue Peter Pet. So no bonus point, Antiphons, but you may have a question. Which would you like?
Water, please.
Water. What will come forth in this sequence? Here's the first.
Film as opposed to the flight itself. Next, please.
October. Months of the year.
September. October. Yes, film set in the year. So a film set in Christmas.
Oh, it's Wonderful
Life. Are
they? Yeah.
Yeah?
Was it 1993, definitely?
Well, it's September 11th.
Okay.
We'll go 12, Home Alone.
And why would that be?
Because it's set in the 12th month of the year. It's a film...
Exactly so. Good early buzzing from you. The numbers denote months of the year. And we're going towards December. What do you think we'd have had for 11?
All Quiet on the Western Front. I don't know.
Do you know what we could have? We got United 93. We
went with you've already gone there.
Planes, Trains, Automobiles, because they're trying to get home for Thanksgiving in that one. No, yes, it is a bit dark, isn't it? We were going to have this in the Christmas special, but the question editor, Mr. Whaley Cohen, felt that it wasn't festive enough, United 93. Although Mr. McGahey said, what do you mean? I watch it every Christmas. They had a huge rout. I heard it through the dressing room wall. But we've elected to put it in this show instead. So any film with a Christmas flavour, Muppet Christmas Carol we went with, or Home Alone. Very well done. One question remains, Suncatchers. It's the Eye of Horus. Picture clues, of course, because we haven't had those. What would you expect to see in the fourth picture? Time starts now.
It's Poppy Ball.
Baby, it's BB.
Then could be.
That's a colour as well, it's like blue.
Next, please.
That's A.
What's the C?
B-A-L-L, so L ball.
Lucy Ball?
Lucy Ball?
Yeah.
Okay, so they might just have her twice, yeah. I think so, yeah.
Lucille Ball.
Well done, Charlotte. You have figured out the entire question there. We've got Lucille Ball at clue three and Lucille Ball at clue four. We are spelling out the word ball in balls. Who are those particular balls?
So it's Bobby Ball, the comedian, Alan Ball, former Everton player, I'm obliged to say, and Lucille Ball, the great old comedian as well.
Exactly so. So their first names begin B-A-L and L. Well done. That means at the end of round two, the Antiphons have 6 points, the Suncatchers have 11. It's connecting all time and Suncatchers. You'll be going first, so please choose lime or water.
Water, please.
OK. 2.5 minutes to solve the water wall, starting now.
Right, planets, definitely.
There's planets, but there's lots of them. Freddie Highmore, Freddie Mercury, Freddie Geraghty, Freddie Stone.
New World's a symphony.
Yeah, Coral is a symphony.
We've got Wedding March. Are they all kind of by the same person? Wedding, New World, Coral, and...
It could be any of the planets, couldn't it?
Yeah. Figure of Speech, Poppy's Red, Mars is Red.
It's got Figure of... What's Speech? Figure of Speech. It's got Brave
speech
New World.
Whole New World.
Could be. I'm going to start doing some.
New World Order?
Yep. Order of Speech. Poppy, Where a Poppy. Right, Wedding March. White Wedding.
Okay. Earth. Let's think about this. So we've got.
Earth
Day, Poppy Day.
Symphony.
New World Symphony.
New World Symphony.
I don't know. Wedding and Jupiter Try.
Wait, Earth Day and Poppy Day, definitely not.
Pop.
London, no.
Speech Day.
Pop Ding.
You've solved the wall. What about the connections? Tell me about the first group, Mercury, Star, and so on.
They're all Freddies.
They're all well known Freddies. Freddie Geraghty, of course, from Freddie and the Dreamers. And the next group, Mars, Neptune, Saturn, Venus.
Planets in the solar system.
They are, and you did very well to solve that when there were still six clues. Very unusual. Good stuff. New World, Coral, and so on.
They're symphonies.
They are symphonies. They're actually all final symphonies by Dvorak, Haydn, Beethoven, and Mozart. All symphonies. And the last group, Earth, Poppy, and so on.
Can all be followed by Day.
Yes, they can. And you just weren't sure. Wedding Day, of course. Earth Day, Poppy Day, Speech Day, Wedding Day. So that is all the connections as well, and the bonus 2 points, maximum of 10. Very well done. Let's bring in their opponents now, give them the other wall, see how they get on. You will be getting the Lion Wall. Antiphons, you have 2.5 minutes to solve it, starting now.
Let's go for, oh, we've got a
planet centre.
Planets.
And we've got, I think we've got, maybe...
Bruno Mars.
Echo Post.
Yep.
Yes, Bruno's Echo Post.
Newspapers and
newspaper
stuff,
Star.
Bruno's. Bruno Fernandez. Bruno Senna. Bruno Mars. Foster. Kirby. So what's Foster then?
So what, how many planets
Foster,
have we got?
Oh, to Foster, to surrogate.
Foster,
Is that mother? Sonny mother? Foster mother, my parent.
Foster Queen mother.
Earth mother?
Maybe. Oh, Mercury is a newspaper as well.
Yeah.
We've got Echo, Mercury, Post, and Star.
Star.
So then you've got Foster, Surrogate.
Earth and Queen.
Earth and Queen, and then you've got Planet. Yeah?
Yep.
Oh, because Earth is not... is in the planet.
May I tell you, that was magnificent to watch. There's a certain genre of team who figures out the wall after about 11 seconds with incredible calm. So you don't notice they've solved it. You're like, oh, what's that? So you go, yes, no, could be mother. So that would leave us with, yes, and that's the answer. I mean, very well done. Unruffled quizzing brilliance. Tell me about the connections. First group, Fernandez and so on.
Brunei. Brunos.
They are famous Brunos. Who are those Brunos?
Bruno Fernandes, footballer.
Senna, Portugal,
F1 driver, Bruno Mars, singer, and Bruno Kirby, I do not know. No.
He's an actor, an American actor. And the next group, Echo, Mercury, and so on.
Newspaper names.
Common names for local British newspapers. And the next group, Jupiter, Neptune, and so on.
Merely planets in our solar system.
Merely planets, but there were lots of them. That was the problem there. And the last group, surrogate, Earth, and so on.
And you can follow those with mother.
Surrogate mother, Earth mother, foster mother, queen mother. Very well done. So that is all the connections as well. And the bonus, you get the maximum of 10 points. Let's have a look at the scores going into the final round. The Antiphons have 16 points. The Suncatchers have 21. So it's quite a narrow gap that can change in the missing vowels round. Fingers on buzzers, teams. I can tell you that the first group of disguise clues all share their names with boroughs of London. Antiphons?
Hackney cabs.
Yes, it is. Suncatchers?
Ealing comedies.
Correct. Antiphons?
Lambeth Walk.
Very good. Suncatchers?
Sutton Hoon.
Well done. Next category, birds and places associated with them. Suncatchers?
Ravens and the Tower of London.
Yes, it is. Suncatchers?
Canaries and Norwich.
Correct. Suncatchers?
Penguins and Antarctica.
Indeed. Suncatchers?
Albatrosses and golf courses.
Well done. Next category, they go back and forth. Suncatchers?
Newton's cradle.
Correct. Suncatchers?
Wrecking ball.
Correct. Antiphons?
Hypnotist's pocket watch.
Yes, it is. Suncatchers.
Is it Foucault's pendulum?
Yes, it is. Next category, they are all banned on British Airways. Suncatchers.
Baseball bats.
Baseball bats is right, banned on British Airways. I myself was the next clue. But there's no time for another clue because the bell has gone for the end of the quiz. And the winners, after a very impressive round four and some very good quizzing with a good total of 31 points, it's the Suncatchers. Very well done. You are through to the next round. Antiphons, you finish on 19 points. So I'm afraid that's the end of your journey this year. But what a great team you've been. You've done some great quizzing, some beautiful singing in an earlier game. Thank you so much for playing. So that concludes tonight's game. But it's a bit too neat, isn't it, to just say the game is concluded. I've learned, writing my new novel, that it's always best to end on a cliffhanger so they come back for more. With that in mind, one of tonight's contestants is an imposter. Roll the credits. Sean.